Hello, I'm Sophie Wendell from Sheffield Digital, and today I'm interviewing Chad Gowler, who currently works as an accessibility consultant but has held many roles in the tech industry in the past. And today they're going to be talking to us about their time as a user researcher. So, hi, Chad.
Hello.
we'll dive straight into the question. So, why on earth did you decide to go into user research?
So I started my career in tech as a software developer about 10 years ago, fairly basic, standard, you know, went to university, got a job, did some tech, did some development. But as I kind of progressed in that career, I kind of realised that technical problems weren't the interesting problems to solve, that everything kind of comes down to a person problem at the end of the day. You know, that you're kind of going, oh, okay, like we need to make sure that, you know, people are using old browsers, for example, can still do something, or, you know, people with disabilities can still do something, or, you know, what do the users want out of the system, right? You know, and kind of how that conflicts with businesses and stuff. So I kind of thought, actually, like, talking about what framework is this and that wasn't really that interesting to me, but I thought, actually, like, no, listening to people and how people work and how people work with technology is actually really interesting. And so I kind of went to a few like UX conferences. So UX is user experience. It kind of covers that whole plethora of stuff to do with users, so like designing interfaces, then the user research and some other bits and pieces as well, writing content. So I kind of looked at all of those jobs and then thought, actually, user research perhaps is the one that I'd like to do, because it's talking to people and I really like talking to people. So yeah, it was a way to kind of still stay in tech, because that's the industry that I know and I have experience in, but being able to do something that was much more around like, how do we actually make the things that we build useful and usable and good for people?
So it's still problem solving of a kind, but some would argue an even more difficult problem is solving what people want from things and figuring that out. So was it kind of an easy transition for you? Like, is there still a heavy technical side to it, or is it really, it's kind of more, it is purely people focused and research around that?
It kind of really varies on the project, but it's very kind of, there's a technical element involved in that. It does involve kind of talking to developers and saying, hey, this is what we've tested this website with people and they couldn't find this feature, or, you know, this wording didn't make sense to them, or, you know, they couldn't fill this thing out in time or something like that. So there's a technical element in being able to at least explain that to the development team, but it's not technical in that I have to tell them what to do or suggest an idea. That's, you know, I kind of, in a way, kind of distill the problems into things that are easier to understand for kind of designers and developers, and then kind of give it to them and say, hey, you know, people had difficulty with this, because I'm not a designer, you know, and that's part of what designers do, is they look at problems like that and say, okay, user needs to be able to do this, and then they do a design that then helps that user, and they solve that problem. So really it's partly problem solving, but it's also partly being able to get quite big problems and talk to lots of people and kind of distill them down into like a small chunk of a problem that kind of other people can take on and then go on and solve. And then we take the things that they've done, then we retest that with people, and then it just kind of becomes this cycle.
Okay, cool. So do you work in a team then, or are you like a standalone bridge between the end user and the developers? Are there other user focused people that you work alongside?
Yeah, so again, it can depend on the organization, that can depend on the project, but it often, most of my experience has been within delivery teams. So it's been working alongside developers, designers, content designers we do a lot of work with as well, because in a lot of ways it's not like the buttons and stuff people have to press. It's, you know, have you given people good instructions? Do people understand what they're about to agree to, or what they're about to buy, or something like that? So kind of I work in what's termed agile, you know, where you instead of doing a load of work up front and then releasing a big thing and then realizing it doesn't work, you know, you kind of release software kind of in stages, and then you kind of go, okay, so we'll try that. Did that work? No, it didn't work. We can change that then. Did that work? And user research is invaluable in that, because that's the bit where you find out, did that work? No, it didn't. And that's much harder to do if you design everything up front and then user researchers come back and go, no, it doesn't work, you know, and then that's like a massive problem. But, you know, the ways that I've worked have been much more like, oh, hey, can we just change this one line here? And like, yeah, cool, we can do that, get that out in a week. Okay, we're going to test it again. Oh, no, that was great. There's also an element of working with people outside of the delivery team, so working alongside business stakeholders, because often they will have things that they need to have in, or you know, things around legal compliance, like, okay, legally we have to use this wording even though no one understands it, which is a lot of battles, you know, but kind of trying to balance that need, and then explaining to them as well, kind of go, hey, these are what your users are experiencing with your product or with your service, and these are the risks that you're taking if you ignore what we're telling you, you know, like, if you don't do this, then you might have, you know, a certain percent of people dropping off, or a certain percent of people, you know, complaining, or, you know, kind of things like that. So there's part of that element too, is kind of being a bit more high level, a bit more strategic, and going, hey, this is what's actually going on with your product, to kind of stakeholders, business folks, and then trying to get them really kind of on board to kind of get that going.
Okay. Yeah, that's really interesting. I think for one, I didn't really understand that there was that much that went in, not that I thought that there wasn't much that went into user research, but I didn't realize that was the scope of it. So that's really good. I mean, this question might be slightly tricky to answer then, but what does a typical day doing your job as a user researcher look like?
So I guess a typical research project will be, you know, so there, first of all, there's a lot of kind of planning. Okay, so what do you actually want to find out, right? And that's a really hard question. You think about it, you know, what do we want to find out? You know, do we want to, because you can't ask something that's too broad, because then you'll never really find anything. But if you ask something that's too specific, you'll miss a load of stuff out. So your part of a project might be, so part of my day might be, okay, what are the kind of big high level questions I want to ask, and then how does that break down into like actual interview questions? Okay, so it might be like, okay, we want to find out why, trying to think of examples. So we want to find out why like 20% of people are dropping off at the checkout stage for a service, for example. And that might be the good big question I want to answer, but the smaller questions might be, you know, kind of going like, what is it about that checkout page in particular? What are people actually trying to do? What stops them? That kind of stuff that you don't necessarily get from kind of analytical tools and things like that. So part of it's kind of that, I'm kind of going, what do I want to ask? How do I want to ask it? Is it going to be an interview? Is it going to be usability testing, which is when you sit with somebody and you watch them use the thing? So for that example, that would probably be a better approach, to go, okay, actually I'm just going to sit and watch you do that transaction, and then when you get stuck, I can be there and ask about it and find out what's going on. There's a lot of logistical work that goes along with that, so finding people to do research with. That's kind of a big chunk of time, so that might be, you know, working with agencies, working with kind of other people, working perhaps with people we've worked with before, to try and find the people that we need to actually talk to. A lot of arranging of, perhaps less now with COVID, but kind of back when we were kind of doing research in person, there's that arranging of, where do we do it, when do we do it, trying to get everyone together. There's a lot of kind of ethical considerations and work has to go into, so making sure we're storing data properly, making sure that we're getting consent and all that kind of stuff. So there's kind of logistics on that end as well, to make sure that we get videos or we get transcripts or whatever of folks, that we're kind of storing that properly. And then there's the analysis bit, where you get all of that data, you know, and you can have quite a lot of it. So I do like 20 tests or something. That's quite a lot of data, because it's not just like a survey where you'd say, yes, they've done it, no, they haven't. You know, you're getting lots of rich information from them. And then you have to kind of stick all that together and try and generate your findings to kind of answer that high level question that you started with. And then part of that, so part of all these processes will touch on other things. So, you know, you do the analysis, and then those findings will go off to various people, and you might do it multiple times, because you might say, well, here's the findings for the developers, but then we've got different findings that are more business-like for the business folks. Yeah, so it's kind of, the typical day is kind of based where we are on a project, but I'd say that would be a typical research project. You know, and then actually doing interviews and stuff is kind of its own kind of skill set as well, being able to do that.
Yeah, so I imagine you mentioned you work in Agile. Was it generally like 2-week sprints that you, so you get 2 weeks to do each thing and then you'd start over, or do you find that it's very variable?
Very variable, and it depends what kind of research we're doing. So it might be that, okay, actually some things might take longer because of the types of people we're trying to reach. So if we're trying to reach, you know, if perhaps we're doing a service where we're trying to actually reach people who people with disabilities, for example, or people who don't normally use the internet, then those people are kind of more difficult to arrange time and interviews and stuff with. And so it might be actually that we can't do that within a 2-week window, and so, you know, actually like that will then kind of roll on. And so sometimes we do get detached from the agile process slightly just because kind of the ramp up times and stuff that we have. But you kind of mitigate that with kind of that constant communication, with getting the team involved. So like developers will come on research with me to do like note taking, so they get to see it and they kind of get to experience those problems as well for themselves. And then that really helps it click with them. They're like, oh, right, okay, it's an actual problem because I've seen it, rather than someone just kind of saying to me like, fix this or move that button somewhere. He's like, oh yeah, I remember because I saw that user, they really struggled. So yeah, that's kind of how we work together.
Okay, so moving on to your personal development as a user researcher, how did you feel that you were supported in both your career development and personal development, so skills areas you wanted to work on?
I think, so it's kind of, it is, can be quite difficult to find junior user research jobs, but I was kind of lucky enough to join a junior program that kind of a lot of companies are doing now, because they've realized you can't just have a load of senior user researchers if you've never hired any junior ones in the first place. So there are a lot more like entry level jobs and stuff like that now. And as part of that, I was kind of being trained, was kind of doing a few certifications, that kind of stuff. I went to university as well, so I did a master's as part of the career change, and that was very heavily talking about kind of research methodologies and things like that. That's not the only way to get into it. I see a lot of people coming across from things like market research, those kind of areas, or kind of any kind of research-based degrees, people coming from sociology backgrounds, psychology backgrounds, those kind of things. So actually, like, as part of that program, I was really well supported. I think kind of my personal development before I got into user research, I really liked public speaking. And so I see like conferences and stuff like that. And that helps with developing those communication skills, you know, and kind of other stuff I did outside of. So I did mentoring, so kind of teaching children how to code, teaching beginner adults how to code. And that really gives you that skill for being able to explain, to kind of interpret between the technical and the non-technical, like being able to explain something very technical like a variable or something to a child who's never done it before, like that's been a really useful skill when I've been doing user research, when I can go, okay, actually I can explain things to people no matter kind of what background stuff they come from, and then like under the other way around, you know. In terms of like personal development, that's where I've kind of focused a lot of my efforts, is around my my public speaking, kind of those interpersonal skills, because they're the ones that are transferable. I mean, they're the most kind of important ones, you know. Like I said, some technical knowledge is good to at least know how things are like done and put together, but it's not essential. Like, you don't have to be able to code anything, you just have to be able to talk to the developers and then to kind of understand what they're talking about in some ways, you know, or just kind of go, okay, you know, like kind of just knowing how software's put together, even if you don't know like the actual intricacies of the code. So just going, okay, so you know, this is what a release is, and this is what each person in the team kind of does, you know, that kind of thing. So it's kind of quite a broad skill set, I think, but it's very communication focused is the main thing.
Yeah, so my next question was going to be, what are the most important skills you need to do your job? I'm guessing communication is the big one.
Yeah, communication is the biggie. Not just spoken, but so there's kind of interpersonal communications. So there's actually when you're sat with somebody doing an interview, you know, you could be doing an interview about something that's fairly innocuous, like I said, like with the checkout example. But you could also, if you're working in something like government, for example, there's a lot of user research, you could be, you know, talking to people about quite difficult life experiences. You know, so there's kind of managing, being able to do that in a way that's empathetic and understanding, but not too, but still kind of keeping that like research professionality, because you don't want to kind of influence the person you're doing research with too much. You don't want to like lead them down the path that you think you want them to go down. So there's that kind of communication, and there's kind of that wider communication with the team. And then there's also kind of things like the public speaking, because sometimes it might be actually I'm playing back my research to a boardroom and I'm kind of doing a presentation about it. So I've got to write some slides and kind of deliver it in that way. You know, it might be written. So a lot of obviously things like analysis and stuff will be like written reports that things get sent off. So yeah, like, communication is definitely like 99% of the job. I would say.
Okay, yeah, so if this was someone who was looking to work on and develop the skills that they would need to become a user researcher, I think you've already kind of touched upon them, which is it doesn't have to be anything technical at all necessarily, like mentoring and public speaking and anything like that, where you have you're kind of forced to kind of consolidate your ideas and simplify them for a wide audience. I guess if people wanted to start working on skills that way through mentoring and public speaking, then that would maybe be a good avenue for them to go down.
Yeah, definitely. And thinking about how you could apply kind of research to your current job if you have one, or kind of other things that you do. So, you know, you might have not thought of it as research, but you might go, oh, you know, we were going to do something at work and I just went and asked a few people about it. You know, like you know, a lot of people have got experiences in doing that kind of stuff that isn't necessarily from, you know, a job that says research in the title. Mm-hmm. Right? You know, if you've ever written a questionnaire for something, for even, you know, for like a charity group or a church group or something that you work with, you know, that's research, you know, and kind of the skills you have to be able to show are that you know what things to ask and find out, and then you know what to do with the information that comes back. So if you've had any kind of career in anything like that, you know, where you're kind of interpreting information that's come back from whatever kind of source, you know, that's a good kind of skill and stuff to have. You know, I'm not saying like go out onto the street right now and start like interviewing random people. It's a skill up, so it can be quite difficult in that sense, that it's a bit harder to kind of do from home than something like programming would be. But if you already kind of work in a role, like I said, I've seen people come into it from various kind of roles and academic backgrounds and other things and kind of other industries, because, you know, it's so being able to kind of explain a complex idea to somebody is kind of a big part of the job as well. So yeah, I'd say working on that communication, but also kind of anywhere that you think about where you've done anything that eventually involves asking somebody something and then doing some of that information. And I think like when you kind of look back through all the things that you've done, you'll probably find something like that, you know, whether it's work or whether it's outside of it.
That's great advice, because I think that is definitely something that almost anyone can do in their job. You know, there's going to be something that doesn't work so well that you occasionally think to yourself, like, there's got to be a better way to do this. Mm. And, you know, user research is kind of just asking the other people in your team, or, you know, somebody in a different department about what they're expecting or how this can work. Yeah, that's great. Thanks. So kind of finishing up here, but what are the most challenging and the most enjoyable aspects of being a user researcher?
I think the most challenging is kind of the most difficult situations you end up in, or where things where I know I'm right, like as the voice of the user, you know, things where I'm like, actually the user is struggling, or this doesn't fit what the user wants or needs, but having that happen, nowhere to go because the business has said no for whatever reason, like the example earlier, right? We have to do this in this way for these reasons, and, you know, well, so it doesn't really matter how many users tell us it's not good, because we have to do certain things in certain ways. But then that's also the most enjoyable, when it does work, when I can kind of say, hey, the user's having this problem, and people go, cool, we'll fix it, and you get to kind of see changes that I've kind of been a part of, and being able to be that voice for people. So it's frustrating when people can't or won't kind of act on what I've found out or what I've said, but it's really fulfilling when they do, and you kind of know that actually there's things that, not just from a user perspective, but it often saves the organization money, because it means they don't have to go out and fix it later and risk, you know, getting bad reviews or something. So we've caught it early and we've been able to fix it. So it's not just, you know, thinking about how I've done good for somebody who's actually going to use something. It's also how I've actually done good for the people I work with, because I've saved them time and money and frustration and having to like find this stuff out when it's way too late.
If somebody was considering starting a career in user research, where would you tell them to start from, like ground zero? What is the first thing they have to do?
That's a really difficult question. First thing I would say would be to find out more about it. So there's lots of kind of like meetups and conferences where you can kind of like, especially now they're all online because they're all kind of inside. And so it's actually really easy to get to a load of these events and stuff now. To kind of have a look and see what kind of other people are doing in this space, and kind of see which bits of it kind of pique your interest. You know, so there's kind of lots of things, actually I can't remember off the top of my head, but there are kind of lots of really interesting stuff that goes on around there. So there's a lot of it kind of in government, so that might be a place to start, is kind of having a look at kind of those kind of jobs, having job descriptions and kind of see what they want, and then see what you have and mesh it all together. But kind of lots of other companies do stuff like user research and stuff as well, and it is quite a big community, you know, and it's quite it's all forms of tech as well. It's not just web, you know, there's a big gamer user, like video games user research community where people do those things that I talked about, but with people playing video games, you know, to make sure that the games when they're released and stuff are good. And there's a lot of that in the UK as well. Not so much in Sheffield, but kind of across kind of the UK. There are some organisations in Yorkshire, I think. So, you know, it's quite a broad, it's a much broader profession, I think people think it is. I think a lot of people have never heard of user research.
I think it's one that's definitely growing. I'm seeing more of, but definitely I think there's quite a few similar job titles, or it kind of gets mushed into the user research and designer title is one I see quite a lot.
You will often see that kind of people just need one person who can kind of do everything. You know, so like, can you research it and then design it and then also possibly build it? We don't know. And I don't think they're very good when you're starting out, because, you know, each of those things are very good, are very kind of distinct key skills. Mm-hmm. And then you kind of have to do a bit of work before you get there. But just kind of checking out what it is and seeing what, like I said, when I thought about moving to use research, I wasn't sure where in UX I wanted to go, because I could have gone into design, or I could have gone into content, or I could have kind of gone out of tech and kind of gone off to other places. But actually kind of going to conferences and stuff was like, oh, okay, these are what the different jobs are. And oh, actually that research that you did seems really interesting. I'd really like to have done that. That sounds like a job I would have liked to have done. Mm-hmm. And kind of then going from there, to then kind of explore like all the events and stuff. Like Sheffield's got loads of good tech events, and they're all free and they're all online these days as well. You know, and that we're lucky as well that we're so close to things like Manchester and Leeds that got really thriving communities as well. You know, so I've kind of done a lot of stuff on the other side of the Pennines, because it's so easy to get to from here. So kind of if you look at the north in general, there's quite a lot of stuff and user research going on, especially as kind of more organizations are moving up north, which is great. So yeah, that's kind of my top tip, would just like have a look, see what's out there, and then kind of see which bit makes you go, ooh, okay, and then you can kind of go from there and see what you need.
Yeah, so start your career in user research by doing some research.
Yeah,
that's the summary. Well, that's brilliant. Thank you so much. That's really insightful. And thank you for giving us your time.
Thank you for having me.
Bye.